Everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of Trackside. I'm Bill Bird, along with Dan Wolf in our studios. And today, well, we're going to look at the seventh stop of the Coors Tour, the Coastal 100 in Wiscasset, Maine. So stay with us. We'll be right back. As we said, it was the seventh stop of the Coors Tour, and while it was up in Wiscasset, Maine, Dan, where is this place, Wiscasset?
Well, if you're from Massachusetts, Wiscasset is about an hour north of Portland, Maine. It is located on Route 1. It's about 20 minutes beyond Freeport, where all the outlet stores are, L.L. Bean's and that sort of thing, about 25 minutes from the state capital in Augusta, and it is also 25 minutes, a half an hour from the Booth Bay Harbor region. It's a picturesque little community. It's the home of the Luther Little, which is a well-documented sunken sailing ship in Wiscasset Harbor. And the track is a little difficult to find. It is nestled in the main hillside.
Well, if you think Dan's a geographic genius, you're wrong. He's from Maine, so he knows the area pretty well. Dan, we got to talk a little bit about the race, the Coastal 100. The crowds, we heard incredible stories over there. You were there.
They were beyond fantastic. The crowds were a record for the Speedway. And I might add right now that prior to the Coastal 100, there were many naysayers that said that Tom Curley and the Coors Tour could not put on a successful race at Wiscasset Speedway. It had been years since the last major race at Wiscasset. So the crowd was beyond excellent. It was a record, and they were very enthusiastic.
Excitement started right away in the time trials. We said Robbie Crouch, 15.281 record. A little bit more about that.
Well, it would seem, if you read the stat sheet, that Robbie Crouch just went out and time trialed, and that was that simple. The real story in the time trials, Rick Craven went out early and turned a very fast time, significantly faster than the other time trialers. And all the way through the time trials, his mark had stood. Craven, the fair-haired boy from Wiscasset Speedway, he'd been Rookie of the Year. He'd been track champion back as an independent on the Coors Tour. Thought that he really had notched his first Coors Tour time trial victory. And then Robbie Crouch came out last time trialer, shaved him 3/100ths of a second and put his name in the record book. So for Craven, it was a real near miss. For Robbie Crouch, his first time trial of the year, and Crouch is famous as a time trialer.
Okay, Dan, now let's take a look at heat action from Wiscasset. And first, the rookie hometown boy made a pretty good showing in that first heat.
Well, Rick Craven was running in the Wiscasset race as an independent with his own team, a distance race car, and surprisingly strong for a young newcomer. He had everything to prove at Wiscasset Speedway. After all, it was his home speedway, and he was running for Rookie of the Year title on the Coors Tour. Had a lot going for him. He came in, he really raced his heart out for the entire day, almost won the time trials, and then in the heat, he ran a very smart, very strong race. You don't get to win them all, but it was a good race.
He finished second, and he finished second to almost an incredible story in Jamie Obey.
Well, Jamie Obey, we have seen the disastrous crash that he had at Beech Ridge early in the spring, out at Wiscasset Speedway, running extremely well. Looks like he's got all the strength in the world. Even more incredible, the night before the Coastal 100 at Wiscasset Speedway, he had won the feature at Breyer Motorsport Park, and that was an event that didn't get over until 1:30 in the morning, and everyone was tired. There had been a lot of bumping and damage and frayed nerves and tempers. So for Obie, just a measure of how tough Jamie Obie really is to run that well in the heat at Superior Speedway in Wiscasset.
Into turn one, takes the lead.
We're underway. Early leader, Fred Wiles. Claude Leclerc on the outside. Jamie Obie in third. Jeff Stevens looks to challenge. Fred Wiles hangs on for the to lead the first lap. Leclerc looks on the outside. This is a difficult track to pass on the outside, and Leclerc crosses over, but they're all right. They're underway. Fred Wiles continues to lead, but Jeff Stevens and Marty LeBlanc have spun in the one turn. Jamie Obie takes over the lead. There is no caution flag. Jeff Stevens waits for the pack to go by, and he is underway. Obie, the new leader. Fred Wiles now second. Rick Craven in third.
Craven on the move.
Craven now pulls alongside of Fred Wiles to challenge for second place. Halfway in heat number one of the Coastal Supply, Motor Supply Coastal 100. Jamie Obie the leader, Rick Craven in second. Beaver Dragon has now moved up to third place. And Craven tries Obie on the outside. Let's see if the youngster can do it. Them in there.
Nobody's running it in there. They need it. Should we call for the fifth time?
This time around, there will be two laps to go. Obie, your leader. Craven second. Beaver Dragon is third. Fred Wiles is fourth. And Barney McRae holds down fifth place. The white flag is out. One lap to go for Jamie Obie.
And there you have it. Jamie Obie edging out Rick Craven in that first heat. We go to the second heat. Kevin LePage was in there for most of the race.
Well, Kevin, early in the 1987 race season, was racing for the Norseman Prescott team out of Ogunquit, Maine. Kevin LePage, originally from Vermont, a bright young driver. We saw Kevin at the race that we covered at Lee USA. He won the semi-feature there and was fast. He did come to some misfortune. Won the early race in the season at Thunder Road, had done a yeoman's job. And at Wiscasset, the car was running fairly well. Things were working fairly well. And he put in a good performance.
Wasn't strong enough, though, in that race. As again, we mentioned him, we always seem to mention him every show, Jean Paul.
The legendary Canadian. I think Jean Paul is more consistent than Canadian Club. For over 35 years, Jean-Paul Cabana has raced in modifieds, late models, any place that he could race. The first time I personally saw Jean-Paul was at Martinsville in 1970. He's the clown prince of the Canadian race contingent, and always fun to talk to, a lively fella, but a very serious competitor. And they take their racing seriously. Earlier this year, when Jean-Paul said that they were running for the championship and that they were serious business, he wasn't just some old guy out there for a ride. He meant it. And he served notice early on at Beech Ridge Motor Speedway and then running well again here at Wiscasset.
Bill Wright, holding the engine to go into turn one, Dynamite Dave Dion from Hudson, New Hampshire, on the outside.
He wrecked last night at Briar. Kevin LePage of Algonquin, Maine. Watch for room on the inside. The streaking street commissioner, Bill Wright, holds the edge as they go into turn number three on the second lap. Dynamite, Dave Dion, oh, a little loose. Kevin LePage drives the car. Fighting to keep that car under him. Oh, LePage down the inside, grabs the lead. Kevin LePage, Jean-Paul Camano looks for a hole under. Wright gets loose. Dion, Shaw, and Ailes get under. LePage, a victim last night of mechanical failure. Jean-Paul Camano right behind him. Dale Shaw looking for room low under Dion for third. They come around, they're completing five laps, halfway this time around. Kevin LePage, Sean Paul Camano, Dale Shaw, Dave Dion looking for room under the kid from Center Conway. Quick. Looking for room around Kevin LePage. Oh, Elston and Wright spin. Yellow on the speedway. In the underway, LePage in the 09. Holds the edge as they go down the backstretch. Cabana fights on the outside. Now tries to tuck in behind the Algonquin driver. Oh, Ailes and Elston together again. And yellow on the speedway once again. Anna into turn one. Grabs the lead on the restart from LePage. Kevin's not going to give up though. They run down the backstretch. Three laps to go this time around. Jean-Paul Camano. Dale Shaw, Dave Dion. Bill Wright and Bob Ailes battle for fifth. Two laps to go. Two laps.
Heat 2, Kevin LePage being edged out there by Jean-Paul Camano. Well, Heat 3, Ralph Nason gave it a go early.
Well, you know, Ralph Nason is an incredible story in Maine racing history. Ralph has been racing since Hector was a pup. Ralph in his mid to late 40s. One of those characters that you meet at the Speedway. Ralph owned Unity Raceway up until this year in Unity, Maine. Finished second in the Oxford 250 way back several years ago and filed a protest with NASCAR, thought he had won the race and let the eventual winner pass him because of a mix-up in scoring. And there's always a story with Ralph. He's a great interview, and he's a tough customer. I can recall him lecturing a younger driver at one of the speedways this year, and he said, if you want to play rough, you came to the right place. Tell me how rough you want it to be. And there's always a story with Ralph. He's a lot of fun.
Okay, the winner, Robbie Crouch.
Well, this race at Wiscasset was very important for Robbie Crouch. Robbie, historically, starts the season very slowly, struggles at the beginning of every year. He's a five-time champion now, and to say that he struggles at the beginning of the year sounds incredible, but this race at Wiscasset was his first day. He won the time trials won his heat race, and eventually did quite well in the feature race. So for Robbie Crouch, this was the first race that really placed him on his way to the Course Tour Championship.
Crouch jumps out to a lead, and behind him racing Ralph Nason in car number 39. Robbie Crouch will be your leader. Ralph Nason is second, Carl Roby is third, Joel Tozier is fourth, Gardner Levitt is fifth, as Gabe. Out of this event, probably with mechanical difficulties. Crouch has set a commanding lead. Crouch shows him just why he's the champion. Back further in the pack, car 52, Joel Tozier challenges Carl Roby. He wants third place. Nason closes on Crouch. Nason able to handle in the low groove, and he closes up on Crouch. Let's see if he can mount a challenge. Gardner Levitt mixes it up with Paul Richardson and Dave Sinclair. The white flag is out for Robbie Crouch and Ralph Nason. Third place, it's Carl Roby. Richardson on the outside tries to get back into a qualified position. And it's checkered flag for Robbie Crouch. Ralph Nason. Third will be Carl Roby. Joel Tozier will be fourth. Too close to call on fifth place.
And there you have that race. As Robbie Crouch there edging out legendary racing Ralph Nason. Okay, in the semis, we have to bring two guys back from the... They were in the heat races, both of them, Ricky Craven and John Paul.
Well, many people don't understand, but on the Course Tour, the semi-feature is a race that is composed of the highest finishing cars from each of the heat races. Depending on how many heat races there are, they will either start the three fastest or the two fastest runners in each of those heat races. It pays a purse, but more importantly than a purse, the semi-feature on the Coors Tour pays 20 points. And the point break-off is much more rapid than in a race. So if you're running for points on the Coors Tour, you have to qualify well, you have to get into the semi-feature, and you have to go out and run that semi-feature to get your points. And, you know, when you see some of the drivers that are going to be there, you know you've got Robbie Crouch, you know you've got Jean Paul, you've got Jamie Obey, you've got Kevin LePage and Ralph Nason, and Rick Craven snuck into that race. And when you have men of that caliber out there, it's quite a race. And Jean Paul Cabana is a good runner in the semi-features. As a matter of fact, Jean Paul won the Triple Crown at Beech Ridge Speedway, won the semi-feature, the heat, and the feature race, and he's quite a competitor in that. Robbie Crouch has gained many points toward the championship over the years in the semi-feature events, and Jean Paul, a very tough competitor.
Closing the gap between himself and third place Dale Shaw. At this fast pace, it is very difficult to pass. Two laps to go. Is for third, Robbie Crouch challenging Dale Shaw. Crouch three-time defending course tour champion, the Allen Lumber Buick. Shaw in the Budweiser, four Thunderbirds. Here they come, the youngster from Newburgh, Maine, 21 years old. Final time out of number four, 20 points, $350. And the check is five for Ricky Draven. Second jump off the Dan and Dale Shaw will be third off. Fourth Beaver Dragon comes.
Okay, and that was Rick Craven, the hometown rookie, 21 years old, taking the semi. Okay, we're going to take a break right now. When we come back, we're going to look at the Coastal 100 feature race. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
Hello, I'm Susan Sullivan for the National Hospice Organization. If you or someone you love has a terminal illness, you should learn about hospice. Hospice is a special kind of care that provides medical and social services for terminally ill people and their families. My father was cared for by hospice, and I know how important it was for him and for my family. Thank you.
Now let's go to Dana Mark at Wiscasset, Maine for the Coastal 100 feature.
Green flag is out. Jeff Stevens jumped out to an early lead. Stevens holds the advantage as they go down the backstretch and complete out number one. Mill Ray holds down second, the battle for third between Fred Wiles and Bob Hills.
And they are three wide in the four turn.
Cabana going three deep on the outside. Dale on the inside, 20, looking for home down low in the middle guard of the back. Jeff Stevens, Canavant, he's out front, opening up a good size advantage. Bob Hales on the outside, takes second from the streaking street commissioner, Milt Wright. Running third, Fred Wiles, Calvin Roby. Ricky Craven and Dion look for him as they come up through the back. Oh, Dan Perez bringing the mountain racing backup machine into the pits.
What a full field of late model sportsman automobiles here at the Motor Supply Coastal 100.
Challenge in the front. Ricky, Red Bear, and Craven, the local favorite, is looking strong.
And Jeff Stevens goes to the pit area.
The leader falls off the pace. Brings his car down 15. That gives the lead to Bob Hales. Hales from St.
The green flag is out. Rick Craven, the leader.
Oh, Hudson, heavy in traffic, moves out the lap car. Joel told you. Paul Richardson's on the inside of Simpson now, challenging for third. Ralph Nason, Robbie Crouch, we've got a war on our hands.
Robbie Crouch has worked all the way up to fifth place behind Rick Craven, Dave Dion, Paul Richardson, Herb Simpson, Ralph Nason. And then it's Crouch and Beaver Dragon.
Keep your eye on the 39. Racing Ralph Mason. He's accustomed to using that front bumper. He'll try every trick in the book to get up near the front of this pack. Paul Richardson, super modified veterans, taking over third. We've got a battle coming up through the pack. Beaver Dragon, a master of traffic. He's managed to grab this spot now. Robbie Crouch runs six. Hudson, Herbie Simpson back to seven. Tom Quinney, Dale Shaw, Dave St. Clair, and Claude LeClaire making up the rest of the top ten.
Craven is fast today. But here comes Robbie Crouch. Crouch running in sixth place. Beaver Dragon has gotten around Robbie Crouch now to take fifth place away from him. But Crouch is fast and...
winding into the final portion of this race. Can Ralph Nason hold off Robbie Crouch? It's turning into another two-car battle. Just like last night, Robbie Crouch is in it. Oh, Crouch looks on the low side. Nason shuts the door.
10 laps to go.
10 laps to go.
And Robbie Crouch makes his move. He's got to do it now. Ralph Nason is top. Robbie Crouch on the bumper. He's going to try Nason. They come to some lap traffic. Nason will use that to his advantage. There will be 9 laps remaining as they come around. Craven pulls in tight for third. Richardson is fourth. The 91 of Beaver Dragon is fifth. The 41 of Jamie Ovie is sixth. The seventh place car number 11, Claude LeClaire. Eighth place goes to Herb Simpson of Hudson, New Hampshire in the black and white car number 3. Ninth place to Dave St. Clair and 10th place to Dave Dion.
seven laps to go as they cross the straight this time. They'll be getting back into lap traffic. Croats, the master of traffic, he might have a shot here. Oh, Nation's opened up a slight advantage. Ricky Craven maintains third. Paul Richardson runs fourth. Fifth place right now is Beaver Dragon. Course to a point leader, Jamie Ovi, maintains sixth position. They come down six laps to go this time. Ralph Mason, car 39, your leader. Croats looking for him on the outside. He's second. Ricky Craven right behind the lead tandem. He's running third. Five to go this time around. Five to go on your leader, Ralph Nation. Nation from Unity Bay, coach from Georgia, Vermont. Ricky Craven, 21 years old. He's from Hampton, Maine. Four to go. Crouch trying to find a bumper on the back of that number 39. Looks high this time. Can he find the room? But he can't find the horsepower.
Laps to go when they come around this time, and Crouch tries everything to get by racing Ralph Mason. And Craven tries to get under Crouch for second place, but Crouch, the veteran, holds him off. They come around now, two to go as they come around, and it's racing Ralph Mason and Robbie Crouch.
Boy, we've had two close to races this week. We're going to have two exciting races here. Robbie Crouch is going to look high on the as they go into three. No, now he ducks down low. Tells Ralph Mason he's here as the white flag comes out. Craven looking for a hole under Crouch. Crouch is going to try the high side. Final time around the speedway. Racing Ralph Mason from Unity Manual leader. Robbie Crouch goes into turn three on the high side. He's going to give it one last shot. But no, he's going to come out short. Ralph Mason, your winner. Robbie Crouch finishes second. Ricky Craven is third. Paul Richardson fourth. Beaver Dragon fifth, followed by
Quite a day today.
Oh, we had a fantastic day all day. We came early and the car hooked up pretty good. We made the right adjustments. My son Ron did a beautiful job, him and Chris. And we had to wind up changing a talk arm in between the heat races and stuff. And we was a little worried, afraid it might have been a little loose, but it didn't get loose till the last 7 or 8 or 10 laps, and then it was a little bit loose, but it was still hooked up pretty good.
How about Robbie Crouch? Did he have enough to get you, or was it just good driving, or how did you keep him behind you?
I didn't have to worry about keeping him behind me. I was going fast enough so he couldn't go out around me, and I was staying in my lane, and he had plenty of room to race. Robbie, ain't nobody better to race with in the world than Robbie Crouch. He's the best there is.
It was a very great last 10 laps in this race as you two tried to shoot it out a little bit, and we congratulate you on your win at the Coastal 100 in Wiscasset Speedway.
Good. Thanks a million, Dan.
Well, Dan, the Coastal 100 up in Wiscasset, Maine, a very exciting race. Not only that, but very competitive.
Sure was. Rick Craven and Robbie Crouch chased the veteran Ralph Nason all the way down to the end. Good competition on the speedway. And a very successful day in general for the Coors Tour.
Well, speaking of successful days, we're going to have a surprise show for you next week, so don't forget to watch. Okay, for Dan, I'm Bill Burt, and everyone here at Trackside, thanks you for watching, so take care. Remember, we'll see you at the races. Bye-bye.